Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Sharmini Pierce, coming to you from Baltimore. North Korea says it has detonated its first hydrogen bomb. Many experts and officials have raised doubts over whether this fourth nuclear detonation was actually a hydrogen bomb. Here's what North Korean television had to say.
선적대시 정책이 근절되지 않는 한 우리의 핵 개발 중단이나 핵 포기는 하늘이 무너져도 절대로 있을 수 없다.
Since this announcement, the United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon denounced it as destabilizing, with the Security Council considering measures against North Korea. In the U.S., the House of Representatives will vote on sanctions in the upcoming days. However, they don't really question how North Korea got this technology in the first place. BBC is reporting that this technology was acquired by North Korea because Pakistan sold it the technology secretly under the watchful eye of George W. Bush. Joining us now to give us his analysis of the situation is Robert Kelly. Robert is a former nuclear weapons analyst at Los Alamos National Laboratory and a former director at IAEA. He joins us from Europe. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good evening.
Robert, as I said in the intro, the BBC is reporting that North Korea actually got this technology under the watchful eye of the Bush administration, and they got it from Pakistan secretly. Is there any reason to believe that?
Well, I haven't seen that particular report, but I think it's well established that Pakistan sold centrifuge technology to North Korea in return for other things. So that report could very well be true. What you have to look at is that North Korea has now had four nuclear tests. The first one barely went nuclear. The second one was also very small. And the last two have been on the order of 10 kilotons, maybe a bit less. So they're not doing all that well at this point, depending on what their purposes are. On the other hand, a 10 kiloton nuclear warhead landing in the middle of a city may not destroy an entire metropolitan area, but look what it did to Nagasaki, and think about how people would not want to stay in that city even if they weren't part of the damage. They would leave. So a 10 kiloton warhead could effectively negate a metropolitan area.
In this report that I was just referring to in the BBC, there's a reference to the fact that Pakistan did sell this knowledge secretly to North Korea, and that the Bush administration knew about it and turned a blind eye. Is there any reason to believe that?
Well, again, I haven't seen the report, but I think we do know without a doubt that gas centrifuges, which are used to enrich uranium, went from Pakistan to North Korea. They also went from Pakistan to Iran. So that's pretty well established. They went from Pakistan to Libya. So we see a real pattern there. In the case of Libya, we know that Pakistan gave nuclear weapon design to Libya, and they may have also given it to Iran. So there's quite a market out there, this stuff moving around. The main difference is that Pakistan, Iran, and Libya have all been working on uranium bombs, if they're working on bombs at all. And in the case of North Korea, you have a plutonium bomb, which at that time Pakistan didn't have. So there are some pretty open questions here, I think.
So then, Robert, what's the difference between Iran having these centrifuges and a country like North Korea having them?
Well, I think the difference is fairly clear. Iran didn't get very far as we can tell. If they worked on weapons at all, it hasn't been discovered. The IAEA has come out with a report saying they find no evidence of it in the last years. Maybe there was some work back in the beginning of the 2000s. And so there's hysteria in Washington over Iran, but a relative lack of hysteria over a country that's already detonated four test devices. I find that quite amazing that the Washington establishment isn't more worried about North Korea than they are about Iran.
And what information do we need to know exactly what happened?
Well, what would really be good is if you get radioactive debris that was involved in the nuclear test. If you could get samples of particles that were released. You could tell whether it's plutonium, uranium, and you can make a determination if it was something called boosted or even a real thermonuclear weapon. Without the particulate or some very reliable source information, we'll never know.
And the U.S. says that they have sent aircraft to collect some of the debris. Is that possible? And then where does that go and how is it tested?
Well, there are lots of people out there trying to collect debris. And what they'll probably first see is radioactive gases, xenon gas, which is a fission product from the test, can leak out of the tunnel where the test was. And that gas is relatively easy to detect. Because it's radioactive, they can make measurements on it, and they can go back and see if it's consistent with the time they measured seismic. But the particles, uranium and plutonium and fission products, don't leak out of the tunnel very well. And so if the tunnel is sealed properly, experience says they won't get anything. From one of the North Korean tests, there was no radiation detected whatsoever. So it's possible they won't see anything.
Robert, explain the difference between an atomic bomb and a hydrogen bomb in terms of how they are produced, as well as the difference in power between them.
An atomic bomb or a fission bomb is fairly straightforward. It splits the atoms of uranium or plutonium, releasing a huge amount of energy in a short period, and that's your nuclear explosion from a fission bomb. You can use the energy from a fission bomb to squash a second bomb, which is only located a few centimeters away. The second bomb contains uranium or plutonium and a lot of lithium-6 and deuterium. Those are elements that will fuse together under tremendous heat and pressure. They release even more heat and energy, and they release lots and lots of neutrons, and those neutrons will burn even natural uranium, which normally doesn't burn in the bomb. So it's a way of getting natural uranium to burn. With respect to the power, a thermonuclear bomb doesn't have to be very big, and that's been mangled in the press the last few days. A thermonuclear bomb can be tens of kilotons, just a few kilotons, but some people think that they have to be megatons or hundreds of kilotons. That's not true. The real reason that people want to build thermonuclear bombs, particularly today, is because they're smaller and lighter, smaller in diameter, and they'll fit on a missile better. Yeah, the United States stockpiling the Poseidon warhead, which was in Poseidon submarines for many, many years, was a thermonuclear warhead with a yield reported about 40 kilotons. 40 kilotons is only twice the bomb at Nagasaki. So you see this furor that we're seeing, the hydrogen bombs have to be big and terrible, is not really true. The reason North Korea would go that way is to make bombs that are about the same size or a little bigger than the one from Nagasaki, but don't have to give a huge amount more yield. It's just in a small package.
All right, Robert, I thank you so much for joining us today.
Okay, good night.
And thank you for joining us on the Real News Network.